Greetings and welcome to another episode of Romero Ramblings. This week we have Bear, Cupcake, Brummie, and this evening's special guest, a mad psychopathic Geordie from beyond the wall.
That was actually pretty amazing. Perfect.
Loved it. So, what's on the agenda today, you guys?
Are we diving straight into this? Or is that how we're working?
Dive straight into it.
Roll our sleeves up. Dive straight in.
Well, in the good news, I just got that achievement. I just won away now from getting that Ironbound Proto Drake.
Good luck getting that next week.
Yeah, well, I can do it on another character.
I know for a fact. You'll get it. You'll take one knock at it. You'll go, bored now. Just move off and try and do something else.
Yeah, pretty much.
Get that sweet heavenly cloud serpent.
Wait, you're not getting that.
Not with that attitude.
Apparently there's a gypsy curse on you that's going to prevent you from getting it.
Well, no, there's a gypsy curse on Snake that prevents him from getting invincible until I get it.
Well, he cursed you.
Yeah, he just cursed me to fuck myself, though, and, you know, that's not an issue for me.
I've got over, like, 100
well,
kills.
Well, I was
going to
say, that's some people's idea of a good night out.
Still never seen a fucking mount.
So then, gentlemen, what's first on the agenda?
The document says leveling.
Leveling.
The document says leveling.
The paperwork says we shall talk about leveling.
The bureaucracy demands that leveling is discussed.
You must talk about leveling within the designated area.
And now we shall go to war.
I mean, like, to be fair, probably the best expansion for leveling so far.
I have to agree. I think they've done a fair bit of work in the lower level experience as well. The lower level experience also being the name of a very shitty Jimi Hendrix tribute act.
is that actually true?
No. Oh. I made that up.
Oh, what?
That I wanted to believe so bad. No, I agree. I think the leveling experience has probably been one of the better sides of the expansion so far. I don't think there's even a weak zone. I think some zones are better than the others. But I definitely don't think there's a weak zone.
Yeah, I think I'm in the same. Like, you know, I could easily order the zones that I like best, but they're all
well,
pretty
equal. Well, why don't you, Jay?
Oh, well, let me just bring up my map here.
Excuse me while he whips this out.
I started at Azuna when I first jumped into it. It was alright. I didn't really have anything to base it off when I first started, so it was mediocre. That's kind of how I felt about it throughout. It was just kind of became, I think, a bit on the dull side to me. There weren't much going on there. Stormheim I liked. I mean, I'm not big on my Nordic stuff like some people, but that, you know, with the definite Nordic theme, Stormheim was fun. High Mountain weren't too bad in terms of the quest in line, but I didn't like how awkward it was travelling around. Saramar is alright.
It's not a leveling zone, though.
Well, yeah. Yeah, content, I mean, I guess, but I was just going through them all. Yeah.
Falchera
is my favourite, though. I just like the area and I like the questing through it. I think most people have been in the same boat.
I think for me it was Stormheim, just for the sort of honest grey main cutscene.
I like Stormheim because it's Viking and metal!
Yeah, I'm the same. It's definitely my favourite one, Stormheim.
Like, this cutscene being my favourite, like, probably in World of Warcraft in general, outside of maybe one of the Lich King ones, where you finally defeat the Lich King, just because it's nice to see Sylvanas and Greymane actually fighting for once properly.
Going at it like knives.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, that's not what I meant actually thinking about it. That means something completely different.
So I have to admit, the amount of hours that I spent in Valshara trying to get this damn fishing rod certainly rustled a few jimmies. Still a nice looking rod.
It is, it's a nice looking, definitely a nice looking artifact weapon. It's probably nicer looking than some of the actual artifact weapons for the classes. like, I'm not a big fan of any of the rogue ones.
Well, you know, tank demon hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like going to Butlins as a kid again and getting them like shitty little nunchucks you could buy at the store before they banned them.
Nunchucks.
Yeah, you used to buy like little shitty plastic nunchucks, like little plastic things on, attaching them together. They broke within 5 minutes. Like everything from Butlins, really. Just like the red coats are.
I like how that's your most selective memory from Butlins, buying nunchucks.
I was thinking exactly
the
same.
Memories I have.
Few now remember the triad wars of Butlins.
I never went Butlins. I just named Butlins because no one remembers the place in Barrow.
Oh, so you never went
to
Butlins, did you?
Ah, no,
so
I was not rich.
You're talking about someone Butlins, but you haven't ever been to Butlins.
Oh, here we go again.
Well, I'll tell you.
The deceit and lies begins to unravel.
The biggest disappointment of going to Butlins is getting there and realising it's nothing like the adverts, trust me.
No, I used to go to a place for Bradley the Bear each year. I forgot the name.
Bradley the Bear.
Bradley the Bear. He didn't touch me.
I'm glad.
It was Haven. Yeah, there we go.
Oh, Haven Holidays.
Oh, Haven.
Yeah, Haven Holidays. No, they were
that
the days.
Takes me back.
I suppose Butlins could kind of be compared with Warlords of Draenor. It wows you with its flashy visuals and promises of amazing entertainment, and you get there and it's like, well, this is shit.
Exactly that, yeah. I mean, in fairness to Warlords of Draenor, the stuff that was there was good. It was just there wasn't enough of the stuff. I would say anyway.
I liked
the garrisons, but it just felt a bit solitude, how it was.
I think in regards to leveling, one of the things I've noticed is that Blizzard have started taking ideas from other games, and they've started to institute that a lot. I mean, especially with the world quests. The world quests are obviously, like, you know, a lot of people are comparing them to Diablo, but I see a lot of Guild Wars 2 in Legion's design, particularly in the way that they've made crafting nodes more shared now, when they've made it so that, you know, it's easier to cooperate with players rather than having to work against them. You don't have to worry so much about, like, quest objectives being stolen.
Yeah.
They've generally made it a more pleasant and cooperative experience, and I think that kind of cuts to the theme of what they're trying to achieve with this particular expansion.
I mean, in fairness, I think it would have been a bit odd in a way, wouldn't it, if they'd kind of got this massive enemy of the Burning Legion and invading Azeroth, but the Horde and Alliance were still like, no, we refuse to help each other in these zones, we're going to fight over quest mobs and be doing PvP all the time for it. So I think they've probably just used that kind of theme and thought, oh, probably this is a good time to actually fix the tagging system.
Yeah, I think they'll always have, like, you know, Horde versus Alliance. That'll always exist to some extent, because let's face it, it's a major game mechanic.
Yeah.
But I think I can foresee them pushing less and less, and particularly in regards to leveling, is to having the two factions separate. I can foresee them sharing zones a lot more, and like sharing areas.
I think that's the best way. I think one of the biggest mistakes they made in Warlords definitely was having two zones that only one faction could kind of go to. I mean, I thought it was ridiculous that I couldn't do Shadow Moon Valley and stuff. I mean, why not? There's lots of orc lore there. I play an orc, and
it's because the Draenei do not like you, Brummie.
Yeah, I mean, they don't. For many different reasons, some of which I can't talk about. But at the same time, I just think if you're going to make an expansion, have all the content available to everyone, don't make them have to have like two different characters for it all.
Yeah, it's about time, really. I mean, I think the thing is, for me, I just find the Alliance lore to be weaker than the Horde lore.
Oh.
I generally much prefer the Horde lore. I think Sylvanas and Vol'jin were much more interesting characters than the King of Alliance has been.
It's personal preference, really,
yeah.
Because I'm kind of like on the opposite. As much as I kind of liked Vol'jin, and it was a shame that they killed him off because he was a really likable character. I don't understand why they felt he had to die, but I've always been, as you know, more favouring the Alliance over the Horde. If I had to choose, I would choose Alliance, but I think both sides are equally as interesting, particularly if you played the old strategy games and you followed the really early lore about like the Sons of Lothar and stuff and what happened to Lordaeron and all that malarkey. It is good stuff. I mean, it's a very lore-rich game.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we've kind of got off the topic a bit now, I guess, as we're talking about just the general lore of the factions in general. But one thing I would say I was disappointed about the kind of the leveling experience with Legion is that I know it's all about fighting the one bigger enemy, but I just wish there was like a slight amount more of some kind of faction specific story. Just because it gives you an incentive, doesn't it, to like level another character? Because for those who haven't played expansion yet, the real only faction specific stuff occurs in Stormheim. I'm not gonna spoil what happens there, but the rest of the expansion you don't really see much of the Horde and Alliance is a conflict, and I was kind of disappointed by that, really.
I can imagine that will be addressed with future content. Yeah. To Legion, but they did say from the start that they wanted to kind of move away from the whole Horde Alliance dynamic and kind of put the power in the hands of the player. Like, you know, although you're just one of multiple inverted commas chosen ones trying to save the world, you're in your own personal story, you're the leader of your faction, and you're trying to get stuff done. When the factions themselves, the Horde and the Alliance, are kind of paralyzed, really, that they're fighting each other. And I can imagine, especially when they start adding content and expanding the story in the zones and in Surma and stuff, that you probably will see a lot more of that, because the Alliance and the Horde are probably going to take more of a forefront in future updates.
Yeah,
I would imagine.
I mean, I don't know right now, to be honest. Conversation CC.
I'm trying to actually think the last time that... I mean, is there a new battleground in Legion? Have they had anything new for that?
Not that I am aware of.
7.1 brings updated arenas. Like, so the TBC ones have been upgraded to, like, look nicer.
But no actual, you know, new kind of...
No, nothing new like that, no.
They've kind of been pushing Ashran, haven't they?
Yeah, I
think they want people to go back there. I'm not exactly sure why, because I don't think it's the best PvP that they've ever done. Let alone even close, to be honest. But, you know, Blizzard are Blizzard. They'll do what they want to do, I guess.
Aye.
I mean, in regards to dungeons, I mean, how would you say that the dungeon content in this particular X-Pack shapes up to Warlords?
You're probably the one who's done the most of them. So you just go first.
1,000 times better. But then again, 1,000 times 0-0, because I thought Warlords dungeons were pretty awful for the most part. I genuinely can't name a standout dungeon from Warlords. I could say that was a really fun dungeon. Like, some good mechanics here and there, but nothing overly special.
I thought some of them had their charm.
They had the charms, they had the appearance, they all felt unique.
I think a big thing for me is, I mean, already, and we're not even at a first content patch, there are more dungeons in Legion than there was in the whole of Warlords.
Oh.
And I think just having that variety means that, yeah, we're still waiting on Karazhan at the time of recording this, but it doesn't matter because the dungeons don't feel like I've overdone them yet.
Yeah.
I feel like there's still enough there that I can do them, and I'm like, oh yeah, this is still pretty cool. This isn't the same old, you know, crap that I've been doing all day, every day.
Yeah.
I feel the only weak one is Violet Hold again, but...
Well, that's basically essentially a reskin of the old Lich King dungeon,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Just not a big fan of, like, gauntlet-type dungeons, where it's just like, oh, kill these, so next mobs, kill next boss, so on.
And I would say that the dungeon content and the quest content as a whole has kind of revitalized the game. A lot of people were worried that Warlords had taken World of Warcraft to a worrying place, but a lot of the old naysayers seem to have been quietened with this new one.
I would say as well, is I know a lot of people, especially on places like Reddit, when I've looked, have leveled the criticism that of Legion. Well, you know, at the start of Warlords, people were really enjoying Warlords as well, but I would already say that there's a thousand more things for you to do in Legion than there ever was at the end content of like Warlords of Draenor, and there's a 10 million more things that you can do that aren't really linked to anything, or just to do for like collections, like mounts and toys and everything. They've really put a lot of detail into it this time.
I think the biggest issue with Warlords is we're used to the 1 year content drought now, but we had 6 months content then just died. Hellfire Citadel came out a year after launch, something like that. The first sets of raids were released way too close for each other as well. Like, I think that really dampened Warlord's momentum. At the start, as much as I didn't really enjoy it, it built up a huge amount of momentum. Like, going in, it's like, this could be good. It's going to be better than Cataclysm. It's not going to be repeat of Pandaria. But, I mean, it's just kind of boring killing orcs all the time. Like, in the end, it's the same bobs. It's the same bosses. It's just kind of boring now with that content they were doing.
Yeah. I mean, as it turns out that, you know, Warlords of Draenor is just one giant expansion to give them an excuse to bring back Gul'dan, really. But I think my biggest issue with Warlords of Draenor was the content they were adding as well was only for raiders. There was not really any kind of content outside of that. I know they added, like, Tanan and stuff like that, but
they added content that should have been in the game about
exactly
launch.
I mean, they said that Tanan was going to be an end level zone, much like I imagine Suramar is designed as now for, you know, for Legion, and then they just didn't deliver on it.
I mean, just Tanan jungle was a very tedious part. I mean, I didn't play it when it was content, came back to the game like at pre-patch. They got through Talon Jungle within a week. It's like, okay, I've seen everything this has. Well, within a week.
I just didn't do it at all. I just could not get into Tanan, even if I tried.
And the other content was gated, which was like finishing your garrison quest line, but it's like, at that point, I just didn't care.
Did you, Tim, play much Warlords of Draenor?
I didn't do much of the dungeon content. I didn't raid at all. I was primarily questing through it. It was I wasn't in a very populated guild back then.
Yeah.
And I kind of have an aversion to group finder. So my general attitude is that rather than use group finder, I was content just not to see the dungeons, have a look at that. I did actually do a few of them, but for a long time, I kind of like trailed behind.
Oh, that's fair.
I'd say with Legion kind of encourages you more to do the content. It kind of encourages you to get out there and do, even if it's just normals, it encourages you to get out there and do it. It's much easier to gear up this time, and there's very little reason for you not to do the content, unless you're like, you know, totally, totally anti-raid, like anti-dungeon finder, like Bri, for example, who refuses to use it because he's had too many bad experiences in the past, and fair play to him, but I will use it if necessary, though.
Well, I'd almost say I'd go further than you and say that you're kind of forced to do dungeons in Legion, because I think most professions and zones lead into them, and so if you want to finish the story, you have to do them, even if
you
are,
and there was one particular review I read for the expansion where it praised it pretty highly. It gave it a score in the 90s, but the person who was actually reviewing it did touch on the fact that you are forced to do dungeon content. And for a lot of people, that isn't a problem, but for some, it feels kind of jarring where you're questing, doing quests, working your way through the storyline, only to be told that, right, okay, you've finished the storyline now, you've got to get a group together and you've got to do this, and this. It's difficult for people who aren't in very populated guilds, or for people who don't have a lot of friends who are so lonely, I have no friends, and they don't have, like, you know, the ability to get a gang of people together and go and do these dungeons. I have to rely on a dungeon finder. And some people don't have the confidence, especially if they're in tank roles or healer roles, to do it.
Yeah, they tell it really... I sympathise with that, was the main story. It's a bit silly, you can't, like, pillars without it, to an extent.
Yeah, I mean, it's only a very minor niggle. I wouldn't say it's a deal breaker, but some people feel it more than others. Like, I know for a fact that if we weren't running the dungeons...
Yeah.
Bri's a perfect example again. If we weren't running the dungeons, then Bryce it probably wouldn't do them. Because he dislikes Dungeon Finder that much, he'd probably just go, right, fine, okay, well, I'm not going to do it.
I can't blame him, really. You get some real characters on Dungeon Finder.
Well, I think that's why they put so many rewards in it for staying in the group. Like, obviously, every time you wipe or someone leaves, you get a buff that increases your damage and stuff like that. So I think they're aware that, you know, sometimes Dungeon Finder can be a pretty negative experience for people, because obviously everyone goes into Dungeon Finder at a different pace, and you can run into people who are good at the game, amazing at the game, or just some people who are terrible at the game. And then in a weird way, it's like, I guess Dungeon Finder was definitely needed, though, because before it was an absolute mess trying to find groups if you weren't in a guild or if you didn't know people. So I definitely think it was a required thing at the time.
Couldn't agree more. It is necessary. It's just some people, I don't know, a minority of people just don't like using it.
Yeah, it's fair. I don't know. I feel like a lot of the issue is, like, there's no, like, real way to balance PvE outside of groups. Because each class is strong at other things and so on. Then you're just making things 10 times harder for one class compared to another. And a lot of, like, the rewards you get from them are, like, the higher-end PvE rewards, and I genuinely believe you should be doing the top PvE stuff for the top PvE gear.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, if you want to get this, if you want to get the best stuff, you have to put in the effort to earn it.
Yeah. I think the fundamental issue of this was that Pillars of Creation are connected to PvE related cosmetics and so on. There's the rewards.
Yeah. I mean, I think Blizzard have made quite a big effort now to make sure that all content is accessible to everyone. Yeah. I mean, but the reality is that in an MMO, some content is always going to have to require you to play it with other people. There's only so far you can go with solo content before people start being like, well, you know, I want to be doing this with others. Raid Finder allows you to raid by yourself now and stuff like that. But
who wants to play an MMO with other people? I mean, that opens up all sorts of problems.
I know. I mean, who would have thought World of Warcraft, most popular single player game?
I mean, that was Warlord's Draenor, mate.
To be fair, Warlord's Draenor did basically become a single player game.
It very much was for most of the expansion, I felt. Yeah, but I mean, I don't know. I just generally think dungeons are the best they've been in a very long time, and they've opened themselves up to be able to make more content easier.
One thing I would say as well about dungeons, which is good this time, is that when you do it on normal, you can then directly learn from your experience on normal to how the tactics change to, like, heroic and then on to mythic as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was basically going to ask. I haven't had much experience in anything other than normals. How have you guys found the progression from normal to heroic to mythic? Sometimes, I mean, some people can find it difficult to progress from the different tiers, but you guys seem to have managed to grasp it pretty quickly. Have you come across any issues or problems that someone might experience moving between the different tiers?
I think, like, you know, us lot, we've done a lot of WoW in the past through expansions, gone through the whole normal to heroic to mythic. The only issue I've noticed is definitely the step up from heroic to mythic. But with my issues with it is normally just because there's someone on the on the team that just doesn't follow tactics.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I just feel tactics are so important now. Like.
Yeah, I mean.
As they should be though, really.
Yeah. Like, there's no like real soft and rages. You can take the fight as long as you want, as long as the healer's got mana.
You always get that one person who will basically look at the large, slabbering, fang-toothed raid boss or dungeon boss you're about to fight and go, tactics! I do not need tactics, they are for the weak! And just immediately throw themselves in and just wipe the entire dungeon group. Then be utterly mystified as to why you're screaming at them.
We had one the other day, me and Brummie, where it was just... We how many times did we get wiped?
Oh, three or four probably.
Yeah, first boss we were getting wiped, and the first issue we had was after the first wipe, our tank just fucked off. Like that was it. We just turned around and was like, there was like bye, and it was like, oh, you know, cheers. Second top wipe, we realised that half of the group was doing different tactics to what we normally do. Which was, you know, just pounding us in the arse for it. And then...
people pay good money for that.
Oh, yeah. and then lastly, one of our fellow clan members thought that DPS was more important than tactics. That was fun.
It was an interesting discussion, wasn't it? Where she was like, oh, I'm just focusing on DPS and... That's probably the biggest thing that switches from normal and heroic to mythic is that, you know, whatever DPS you're doing is fine, and there is definitely a minimum amount of DPS you need to be doing, otherwise the bosses just hit soft in rages. But, you know, the most important thing is that you're dodging all the stuff and kind of paying attention to what's going on, and I think that's probably what Blizzard intended.
I feel the only time...
you've got to get on that parser.
The only time it really matters what your damage is when you're doing stuff like Mythic Plus. Way against the timer. If you beat the timer by so much, you'll get more rewards and so on. But lower damage will definitely hold groups back on that.
Well, you know, speaking as a protection paladin, I have the damage of a small asthmatic child. So, you know, I'll not exactly be scaling any DPS passes. And if I am, I'm clearly not doing my job. It's like, what are you doing? Why aren't you taunting?
I need damage! You don't understand! I've got to get damage!
That's like Secret Rogue in my days, though.
I mean, the thing is, though, is that a tank will never be expected to be topping the damage. It's when you get kind of DPS who get so locked onto the idea that they need to be topping the meter. And it's kind of one of the negative aspects, really, these days of having... of having things like recount and stuff so commonly used is that people get so hooked on it that they don't realise that there's more to it than that.
Oh.
Good, yeah, but don't stand in the fire.
Exactly.
I feel the biggest issue with recount and stuff is like EP and stuff like, oh, look at me, I'm doing all this damage on like a trash bag.
Yeah.
No one cares.
I mean, I can definitely see why people use it, because at the end of the day, everyone likes to be able to be like, well, look at me, you know, I'm doing this, I'm doing that.
Look at me, I'm Billy Big Dick this week.
Exactly, but...
I thought I was.
Well,
mate.
Maybe one day. If you ask nicely.
I think
you
should write into the makers of Deadly Boss Mods and make it so when you've got the highest DPS, it just flashes up in big red letters, Billy Big Dick! repeatedly notifies the rest of the group that you are now Billy Big Dick.
What I would like is basically for there to be almost a setting in recount, whereas... If you're doing top DPS or DPS at all, but you stand in the fire, it resets your DPS on the meter to zero.
Oh mate, that'd be cruel.
Yeah, so, but it would teach some people.
Exactly. I mean, how quickly would people learn not to stand in the fire?
You then get the temporary title, John Junk.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, any of you guys use logs at all or read logs?
No,
As you say about the damage stuff, like this is why for me logs mean 1,000 times more than a recount ever will. Because with logs you can see when people are taking unneeded damage and so on.
Yeah, it's not something that I generally tend to use much myself. I did in the old days, back in my day, when I used to play EverQuest 2, you know, back in like the 80s and stuff.
Just well, like back when you're in your 50s, mate.
Yeah, back in 1952. Oh. When, you know, when EverQuest first came out, we used to have the parsers, which would basically list all the DPS, what they'd done, how much damage they'd done, and it would be quite competitive.
Yeah, I think DPS is competitive. I think it always will be, really. There's something to say, look, I'm doing my role better than this guy here, and this, and what's he doing different that I'm not? See where I'm going wrong?
Yeah, some classes in some MMOs can be fiercely competitive. Warlocks in EverQuest 2 were a damage class as opposed to a pet class like they are in WoW, and they were really, really... It was basically an AP in contest.
Warlocks are still an AP in contest. Who can do the worst damage these days, but you know.
Oh, brutal.
Who can CR the warrior at the worst time so he can get rotted and have to run away from the bob? Boss.
And you've already done the first raid, haven't you?
Done
Cupcake?
5 out of 7 on normal.
How did you find it?
It's a hell of a lot of fun.
It's a lot of fun, isn't it? So you'd say it's a very good sign of things to come.
Yeah. If we continue like this, and with what they've been saying so far, I think this could be like the best Xbox since Warlock for me.
That's a bold claim.
I would say as well, as I mean, I was in the beta for Legion, so I got to do the Nighthold as well, or well, at least kind of talk to a lot of people who'd been doing it, and they were also saying that, I mean, obviously a lot's going to change from when it releases, but they were saying as well that was a lot of fun, and there was a lot of good mechanics. I mean, how did you find it, you know, the Emerald Nightmare Cupcake compared to say like Highmore when it came for like levels of enjoyment?
I think it's on par, because I really enjoyed Highmall.
I was going to say, I mean, Highmall is a very good raid, that's why I was asking for the comparison.
I felt Highmall had, like, the perfect difficulty curve on, like, normal and heroic. Mythic, it was a bit all over the place, but all Mythic raids are when, like, Highmall was. Where you can, like, choose your boss order, really, but I feel... It's got, like, you've got your basic first boss, your standard gear check boss. I'm really looking forward to seeing how the extra mechanics work on heroic compared to normal.
I mean, I'm very much looking forward to as well seeing if how, I mean, because I used to raid, and then I scaled down to kind of looking for raid because I just didn't have the time. So I'm going to be very interested to see how they scale down the mechanics to looking for raid, because they seem this expansion to be quite happy not to make things too easy, which is good because it's a big complaint against the game often that things have got too easy for all these filthy casual players. So I'm kind of, you know, I'm wondering if this is going to translate to looking for raid, and if, you know, LFR is also going to have a same kind of difficulty.
I hope so. There's a few things I'd like not to see, like the Ursoc fight, with the charge mechanic tuned differently for looking for raid. Currently, you've got to, like, stack the raid to go to be charged at, so the main person doesn't take too much damage. But I just feel stuff like that was never going to work with 25, 30 unorganized people.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think certainly there's going to have to be some mechanics changes, or there's going to be a lot of wipes. I mean, often there always is in the early days of LFR. But I've one thing I've got to say, because I watched some footage of the Emerald Nightmare stuff last night, is that I was impressed because Blizzard, to be fair to them, have always been quite good at doing raids. But I definitely felt like all the bosses looked different. I mean, did they feel different when you were
the
fighting
The bosses
them?
Feel different, definitely. Feel a lot different. It's not like, what's it? Hellfire Citadel. Like, I only raided Hellfire Citadel for 3 weeks and everything just felt the same. Blackrock Foundry, everything felt the same. Like, you had, like, this. Personalities of some bosses, like the Arnie boss. Like, the, what's it called? On the left, on the train track things.
Yeah.
I forgot the name now. Handscar.
Yeah.
Like, you'd have, like, stuff like that, where they'd have personalities come through. And you'd have Ogorja, which was stuff of people's nightmares. But most of them just didn't have any personality or anything that, like, make them stood out for me.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that I think as bad as the Warlord's content was, and this includes Hellfire Citadel and everything, I would say even then though they're probably not the worst raids I think I've ever done in WoW. I mean, I think probably the high point of raiding was, for me anyway, was Wrath of the Lich King. I thought all those raids were very well done.
Wrath of the King was when I started.
Especially Ulduar. I think Ulduar was probably the best raid they have ever made in the game, with all the mechanics and how it all kind of ties together. But I think for me, the worst time and the worst raids ever made was simply Cataclysm, where I think they were almost trying too hard in an odd way.
I think you're like a good boss.
You say Cataclysm. Cataclysm overall was just awful, in my opinion.
I don't think it was terrible. I don't think it was anywhere near the best expansion I've ever done.
I really thought the first 10 raids in Cataclysm were brilliant. You had some brilliant fights there. They were simple and yet complex. You know, it had the right balance for a lot of them. I just felt the issue was you had 3 raids, you had to pick and choose between where you want to go. I just feel that's an awkward idea.
I totally missed Cataclysm. I never did any of the Cataclysm content. I was away from World of Warcraft when it happened. I like to think my character was asleep and he woke up to find the devastation going, what the fuck just happened here?
I can't remember at what point you came into WoW.
Me?
Yeah.
I originally first started playing WoW as a form of social experiment. I used to, as I mentioned, I used to play a game called EverQuest 2. And EverQuest 2 at the time was like an alternative to World of Warcraft. And it was full of a lot of ex-World of Warcraft players. And you know those Brits who often go abroad? They're called expats. They go abroad and they basically, like, you know, spend their time in Spain and Greece or whatever, just like, you know, going to English theme pubs over there, drinking the same stuff they drank at home, eating the same stuff they ate at home, and just bitching about how terrible the country is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
EverQuest 2 was full of the MMO version of that. People who used to play World of Warcraft but now played EverQuest 2 and who just constantly bitched about how terrible World of Warcraft is. And what can I say? I got curious. I decided, nah, this game can't be as bad as what they're saying. It can't be. I'm going to try it out and find out. And I started playing, I'd say, probably midway through Wrath. I came to the conclusion that, yeah, they're right, it's horrible.
Wrath of the Lich King was definitely the high point, wasn't it? It's probably the best expansion they ever did. I mean, sometimes you play through it now, and it's awful, but I'd say definitely it was the best expansion that
I never reached
made.
It. I never reached it. I got as far as Burning Crusade, and my interest kind of petered out, and I stopped playing it. But I was convinced by a friend to go back to World of Warcraft a couple of years later, and I had to, like, remake a new account because my old one had been hacked, so I was starting again, and that's generally when the game kind of got its teeth into me. And I started playing, the thing that made me come back was when they announced that they were basically releasing all of the content up to Pandaria for free.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's kind of what made me return to the game. And so I started playing just at the tail end of Pandaria when people knew Warlords was coming out and they were starting to prepare for it.
I think it was a good move, though, when they did that with Pandaria.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Wants to take out.
I was just going to say it seems to be what they're doing for the future now. They've done the same thing with Warlords, yeah.
I think
it's just like... connected to the Sorry, go on.
It's great because it reduces the cost of entry. I know when I first got into it, I first got in at TVC. I never raided then, but I dabbled in it. It's like, this is really fucking expensive. I'm paying 80 quid here. So if you were paying... say it's still a 40 quid base, well, I mean, it's like a 5 an hour, but a point if you're paying like 40 quid for the base game, then another 80 quid for expansions to play what? Like, it's like
Well, I mean, I remember because I think out of all of us here, I'm the one who's probably played the longest out of WoW. I think.
Yeah, probably.
Well, I played vanilla.
But yeah, but I was gonna say I think I probably got a bit more hours in.
It's like the old joke: how do you know someone's played World of Warcraft vanilla?
Because they'll bring tell it you. Up. Yeah. Well, I do. I just remember I remember getting to Cataclysm. I think Cataclysm was still where they had a lot of disc releases, and I was like beginning to think they're gonna have to make all these expansions just one base game, else it's going to get to the point where it's like a 24 disc install and it's going to just cost about like £300 just to start the game. So I think Blizzard probably recognized that making as many expansions as they did, they are going to have to start just making them all for free when a new one comes out.
Well, I was going to say, like, speaking of a lot of clan members stuff, and you know, some of them old players from back around TBC or Cataclysm / Lich King. And, they've all been very convinced to come back to it because they've not played Pandera or Draenor, but they've been very convinced to come back to it. Seems that they can get all of that stuff added on. They just purchased Legion.
I feel like for me now the big draw is being able to drive Team Cross from. I'm not in the same realm as the rest of the clan because I raid with another guild. I've raided on Draenor most of my raiding time. And it's always been a fun realm for me, but like being able to like log on and play with my mates without being on the same realm is really, really fun.
Well, I think as well they recognise the fact that the player base was fading. And because the truth of it is WoW's lost a lot of players since it was in its peak, and I think they realised that they needed to make sure that the players who were still here could, you know, with any way possible, still play with the people they wanted to play with. Yeah. I think Cross Realms are the natural kind of extension of that.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, nothing. There's nothing better when you're going into a dungeon than having a big skeleton with huge boxing gloves rock up and start punching things for you.
Yeah, from another realm. Far away.
From another realm, far, far away.
To be honest, I mean, we all, the clan plays on Argent Dawn, though I don't think any of us are actually role players. So, I mean, I'm sure on Argent Dawn you could definitely find some people who would definitely tank anyway in a full skeleton and pirate outfit. I don't think that would be too hard to find.
I don't know, I was role playing last night. I was role playing as a slave trader trying to sell Laura off for being useless. I mean, I said in the trade chat I offered a useless woman for 10k and someone said sold. So, I mean, unfortunately, she wasn't very committed to the role playing, but you know,
the internet is truly a desperate place.
Trade chat is back to its full peak of amazingness. With this expansion, I have to admit, I haven't seen it this active and actually this funny for a while.
I've started to get a bit of a rep on the trade chat myself.
For slave trading.
Oh, just normally because for the audience, those that don't know, I've been dedicating a lot of my time to fishing. As you can see, I've got this really nice fishing rod now, but. Had to collect all of the rare fish in bloody the Broken Isles, and to get like lures and stuff, I've had to sit and fish in Dalaran for absolute hours. Took me about 4 days to finish it all, but yeah, just due to me sitting around fishing day in, day out, what better thing do I have to do than chat shit with all everyone else chatting shit in the trade chat?
Yeah.
To the point that yesterday when I started chatting shit again, somewhat, you know, you get people that pop up and recognise you, like, oh, Poise, you're back in the trade chat again. It's like, ooh,
that's
me,
definitely
I'm
not something
now.
To boast about, is it really?
Yeah.
Not really, no.
Oh, sorry, I thought I was, you know, top 50 in trade chat.
Here we fucking go. Can we just not bring up big old race stuff, please? Thank you.
Okay. I mean, I...
Don't worry, Cupcake. You'll always be in my top 50.
Bless.
Pam. I really want you to know you're a son of a bitch.
Oh, that's... that's... We'd kept this podcast so clean, boys.
I mean, I was talking about getting pounded in the arse earlier, but you know.
Exactly.
That's very true.
That really isn't used in conversations as much as it should be these days, you son of a bitch.
It is. It's an underappreciated swear word, like bollocks, I think.
It tends to have a bit more gravitas if it's spoken in a Mexican accent.
I would try, but I really don't want the
son of a
bitch. I mean, it's already, as I say, it's been done. I didn't want to risk the legions of people who would take offence at it coming after me.
Oh, it's all right. It's only Pedro.
Would be offended by it.
I was going to say, if Pedro ever listened to this.
I think Pedro would listen to it while he goes to sleep to help him sleep.
Pedro's never played WoW.
I'm just suggesting he hates WoW and it'd bore him to sleep.
I would say it's probably the best expansion if you were going to get into WoW to try it, I think, so far. With the level 100 boost, I think this is definitely the expansion. If you've been on the edge about whether or not you would enjoy the game, this is the one you should try it with, because this is the one that feels the most complete so far.
I would very much say so, yes. And they do give you the option of trying different classes before you determine which class you want to dedicate your boost to. So yeah. You do get the option of like trying different classes, trying to find one that's good for you, and you know, all that malarkey.
Don't spam that, trying to find which class, because I tried to find what to waste my 100 boost on, and it kept blocking me, saying, "You have tried too many classes today. Come back in 24 hours." What?
First one's always free, Bear.
Don't you think, though, it's the most... Probably a feature I'd never thought about, but a feature that should have been in the game from ages ago. Like a way of testing the class at top level to see if you're going to enjoy it. I think that
I quite like that they've added it in, you know.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it's actually one of the most underappreciated features of Legion, the fact that they've added that in. Because... What? How many times I get a character to level 20 and then think, do you know what, this is shit, and that I can't stand the character at all.
I was going to say though, like a lot of the thing is though, as much as earlier you was talking about having played, logged the most amount of hours out of any of us, I'm sure you probably in the same boat as me, where even from when I started in vanilla, I've not really fluctuated between many classes over the entire expansion I've played. Pretty much in vanilla I played Hunter. After vanilla I never played Hunter again. I practically... My most played class has been Druid throughout. And then Lich King, I went full Death Knight, and now I'm playing Demon Hunter. So, you know, even though I've played since vanilla, I've not exactly experienced many of the other classes, but I think that a lot of people, you know, have already been in that boat where they have experienced a lot of classes. So unless you're a new player, you're not really going to, you're not going to hear much appreciation for it.
I mean, after leveling enough cards to 100, it's like, just the change of pace of a character between, say, 20, 30 to 40, 50, it's just so big each time. Like, every 10 levels, so much changes.
Yeah.
I think as well, with the way they've changed the talent system and the way that you can even choose talents now, I think the game is designed with the whole kind of talent system based around the fact that you are, like, level 100 or above, because it obviously affects your class so much. And I understand why they do it, because it's almost like, we don't want to give you too much too quickly. But I definitely think the 100 character boost is something that should have been in the game for so long now.
And you mean the class trial?
Yeah, class trial. Well, the 100 character boost as well, because I think you should have the option. Maybe not for everyone. Maybe not for people who don't have a level 100 or above already. But I think if you've done the content, you should be able to skip ahead to current content, really. Even if you have to pay.
I
just think it's nice because TBC and Wartlock are awful now.
I was going to say, what, you're paying about 40-odd quid for Legion alone.
Yeah.
And a character boost alone is 40-odd quid, so, you know, yeah, I mean, really you're saving a nice 40 quid by getting that extra thing thrown on top.
Going back to the abilities and that, it's like, you've got to balance it. It's like a competitive game. You've got to balance it based on the total of a play. Not like people are playing it casually, not people that are like coming home from work, playing it for a few hours a night, maybe. It's got to be based on the guys that are at a very top level.
Oh yeah, for certain.
And can you just imagine Street Fighter being balanced around us lot in the flat? It'd be awful. Hadouken might be a lot more viable, but it'd still be bloody awful.
Well, I mean, I do know what you're saying in some kind of aspects, and I do agree, but I think at the same time, you do have to make sure the game is tuned for all levels of play, even if it's not perfect for low-level play. I definitely think that you have to make sure that it still runs smoothly and that things aren't too overpowered in the lower levels.
Yeah. I understand essentially what they're doing with lower levels is that they're making zones scale now.
Yeah.
They're basically doing what they do in the likes of Guild Wars 2, so that when you go into a particular zone, it'll scale to your level. The rewards you get will basically scale to your level. I don't know if they've implemented it yet, but they have been talking about doing something like that.
It's not been implemented.
To try and increase the longevity of the older zones and make the leveling up a bit more interesting and bearable.
Like, well, I think... Sorry, go on, Ethan.
Do you like part of a quest chain and you're already like out leveled the zone and you've got to go on to a new quest chain? It's like you don't even finish a single story anymore.
I think they've done a good job though with heirlooms and stuff to try and make getting to top level as easy as possible if you've not experienced the content. But I think they're probably around due for another kind of dare I say cataclysm expansion where they redo the leveling experience somewhat, just so just to keep the early game fresh. Because I mean, one of the best things about Cataclysm was the complete new 1-60 content.
Yeah.
And the stories that came with it.
I feel that needs to be done for TBC and Wartlock so desperately.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, even if they just kind of ditched the Burning Crusade, I wouldn't mind too much. And just kind of did something, I don't know how they would do it with Wrath of the Lich King, where that was like your stuff from 60 to, I don't know, 90, I guess, for Pandaria. I mean, it's probably impossible to do because of the amount of levels you'd need, but I just think that would be... It's so... Especially the Burning Crusade now, because that is the oldest content. It's so agonising to go through.
For me, you could skip up to Cataclysm content and be fine, because Cataclysm's like a couple hours. It's so short now, and it's a lot of fun still.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so all the latest expansions questing content isn't bad. I mean, Warlord of Draenor takes a while, but the rest of them, I think, you know, they're very easy to level through. The story's usually pretty good, with the exception, I think, of Cataclysm, where the story of the zones doesn't really link together very well.
I think they were self-contained stories for each zone, which I thought worked really well.
I think it does, but I almost kind of prefer how it works in Legion, where they are self-contained, but they all lead to the Pillars of Creation, which kind of all connects them all together at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, anyway, what are your thoughts on professions then, in this expansion?
Well, that's probably the area that I'm happiest with and unhappiest with. Because, I mean... I don't know how many of you guys have tried archaeology.
Yeah, it's awful.
Yeah, it is literally one of the shittest changes I've ever seen to a profession in a game. It is literally so bad. I don't know who thought it was a good idea. Basically, for anyone who doesn't know, what they decided to do, and I, like I said, I am completely unaware why they decided to do this, is now the rare drops that you got from archaeology, the stuff that was usually the actual stuff worth getting, you can only get once every 2 weeks from a quest. And at the same time, you can only do archaeology in one zone every 2 weeks, and then it swaps around. Awful change.
I agree. I mean, That's probably the worst profession in the game.
The rest of the professions, or I have to say, I really like what they've done with them. The fact that you have to do a quest chain for the profession itself. I mean, the only one I've had experience with doing is blacksmithing, but I've loved doing the blacksmithing questing. Just purely because you do feel like you are advancing your craft.
Yeah.
It is actually really rewarding. And I'm curious to see what the other professions' quests are like. It's actually...
I'll tell you what isn't fun, herbalism. I love a good bit of herbalism throughout WoW, but me. In Legion, it's just, like, there's some maps like Val'Sharar and Suramar. Those two have quite a lot of plants and stuff, but I think it's Stormheim and High Mountain that are pretty weak with the amount of herbs that they have around the place. Which is alright until I actually need like fox flower.
Hmm.
Which is annoying because I seem to get a lot of quests that are about getting fox flower.
My other criticism of herbalism and the gathering professions actually in general is that Like you, Tim, I think the only non-gathering profession I've done the quest chain for is blacksmithing. But that quest chain really engages you with the profession. You'd spend a lot of time kind of really learning about everything you're making, whereas the herbalism and the gathering ones are a lot of just, oh, you've gathered 20 of this thing, you know, now you can get more of it. It doesn't really go into much explanation.
Yeah.
It kind of does so with, Stark Rose, where you pick up the hand shovel thing.
Yeah. But, I mean, the Starlight Rose, that's kind of just one small example, whereas with the blacksmithing chain, there's like a whole, you know, kind of process of slowly advancing what you're making, whereas you get special items that you make for the NPC to kind of, where you're both, you and this master blacksmith in Dalaran are kind of discovering the techniques to make this Legion stuff together. And I just feel like they missed a trick there with gathering. I'm not sure how they would have done it, but it would have just been nicer if the gathering quest chains were equally as fun.
Yeah.
I mean, okay. I'm not complaining too much. I mean, I've got a lot of my gathering levels, not the herb level itself, but as in through the quest line. A lot of the herbalism skills I've got now, you know, the first load it gives you is all collected more efficiently. The second lot, which I'm on with most of them now, are just me like rare materials while I come up as well. So that's pretty nice. I get some good stuff out of it. Not to mention, you know, at the end of the day, even though I complain about how sparse some of the herbs are, the was it Star Rose? Starlight Rose selling for 200 earlier per one.
Yeah, I'm paying like 200 per herb for Love Alchemy.
Early expansion is always just an absolute mess on the auction house, so.
I feel the biggest issue I've got with professions now isn't just the archaeology, it's the procking for like level 3 recipes is a bit grim. I've done over 100. In Frost now, I'm still not proc level 3, but Agility 1 was like, 20 Frost now is level 3.
Yeah, I'm assuming it's like a random element, that causes it to proc.
We'll also say that if anyone, for whatever reason, cares about fishing, Legion is definitely great for fishing. I did find it in one of the guides prior to me going achievement hunting that going for the rare fish in general helps you to boost skill. I'm pretty sure that within 2 days I went from 150 fishing skill to max level 800.
Aye.
Ridiculous. And then, of course, you know, as I mentioned earlier, getting this amazing fishing rod.
You've turned into that guy, haven't you?
No, right. Apart from the fact that it looks cool, you know, it's... It feels like it's a physical achievement, you know. Apart from me getting the points for basically unlocking it, it's also something I can just like wave around at the ponds and stuff. And you know, it's cool because like the little arms on it has got physics as well, as you can see in the video. Well, not you guys, but also it works like the artifact weapons, where when you have it, you go fish up other rare fish, and then you it gives you artifact power for the fishing rod, and then. So, well, the main powers that it has is like you can walk on water, you can become a fish underwater, enemy detection like 5 increased another 5 yards out, and teleport to like the closest pool. They're really fucking good, like especially considering that you can make a lot of money off doing the fishing stuff.
I have been impressed that they're trying to make some of the more kind of mundane professions, I want to say, more interesting. It's just why, to me, they decided that the way to make, archaeology more interesting was to limit it, to me. That seems to be the real shock.
Oh, sure.
Because, I mean, the reason why people do archaeology is purely for, like, the toys and
toys.
And the pets.
Balance now, Loomis. Like, you get all this cool shit from archaeology, but if I'm limited to, like, once a fortnight, it's, like, it's a bit... There's no random element to it, it's not fun.
Well, it's that and the idea that, you know, there's only, like, 5 common artifacts per zone now in archaeology.
Yeah,
and these quests, like the one for the week that we're recording this, is to do 25 artifacts for. So it's basically the same 5 artifacts over and over and over again, and they just take so long. And there's only like 3 dig sites as well, so it's just going through them in a cycle until you kind of finish the quest. It's all very odd.
Yeah, but look at the bright side. At least you get to wear a fedora and randomly yell, "It belongs in a museum!"
That is very, very true. I mean, I suppose I can't really moan, can I? Knowing that I can do that.
Perks, my friend, perks.
So, I'm trying to see. I think, I want to say we've basically...
We have covered everything.
Covered everything now.
And we've must have hit the hour marker as well, so...
Yeah.
So I guess all that remains to be said really is bye from me. You see, I was expecting you all to kind of follow that
bye
up.
Bye from
then.
Me.
Yeah.
Bye from me as well, I guess.
Farewell.
I just feel like I've been off stage completely now.
Well. In fact, I said I was expecting you all to follow me, but then I realised we should probably say if you're interested in playing with us on World of Warcraft, you'll find us on Argent Dawn, both Horde and Alliance side. Most recognisably on Horde side, we are in a guild called the Romeros. Come say hi. We'll probably be like, what the hell? You've actually watched this YouTube video that only 5 people ever watch, but you know. Come say hi regardless. But I just thought we should probably mention that in there as well. I guess this is the end.
I don't want to steal your moan and wrapping it up, mate.
Yeah, we enjoy
you're
you
liking
wrapping
and
it
subscribing,
up.
Like...
Oh yeah, you see, I can't say that you feel this is definitely early days for this podcast, but it definitely is. I actually wondered why I kept getting message alerts telling me to say something that I wasn't reading, and then I was like, oh, right, okay. Please don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and make sure to check us out on, on the Romero's website, on Facebook, and on other forms of social media, including Twitter and Reddit. And you might get to meet our wonderful recruiters and join the clan, including me. So, yeah. Thanks, shitlords. Bye. That sounds fucking awful.
I mean, I want you to draw this.
I mean, I would draw it, but my drawing would probably look more like a hairy testicle than it would a blue onion.